Thanks for joining us for Ruth Institute's podcast. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org. We seek to change the narrative around marriage and family to create a cultural climate favorable to lifelong married love. We also seek to promote recovery and healing from the wounds of the sexual revolution and share our stories with the next generation. I encourage you to visit our website, where you can sign up for our free e-newsletter and receive more information on what we're doing around the country and how you can be involved. Dr. J is once again Todd Wilkins' guest on Issues, Etc. They're discussing the Day Without a Woman strike.
When women's rights are under attack, what do we do?
Stand up, fight back!
Some sounds from the A Day Without a Woman protest. Being called a strike, people staying home from work, women encouraged to stay home from work and spend the day either not working or out on the streets protesting. I don't know. I saw one of my friends looking at the news coverage, and he said it looks just like a pro-abortion rally to him. A lot of abortion signs in the national news coverage of the Day Without a Woman protest. And a few about some other issues, but again, it does look more like pro-choice rally than about broadly protecting the white rights of all women. Do such protests, does such a strike speak for the American woman in general? We'll be answering that question live on this Wednesday afternoon, March the 8th. I'm Todd Wilkin. This is Issues Etc. Thanks for tuning us in. Dr. Jennifer Roback-Morse of the Ruth Institute will be our guest for the first few minutes of the program. Dr. Jennifer Roback-Morse, founder and president of the Ruth Institute. Jen taught economics for 15 years at Yale and George Mason Universities. She is senior research fellow in economics for the Acton Institute and author of several books, including her latest, The Sexual Revolution and Its Victims. Jennifer, welcome back.
Thanks for having me on.
Just your gut-level reaction to the idea of a strike or a protest, whatever it is, called A Day Without a Woman.
Gut-level, this is just another leftist protest. It has all the earmarks of a leftist protest. It's their, what shall we call it, their idiom. It's all spoken in their idiom. Some of the buttons that you see are a capitalism unfit to save the planet. You know, this type of stuff. It's playbook right out of another leftist event. That's my gut level reaction to it, Todd.
What is it supposed to be? What is it being billed as? Why is it being held in the first place?
Well, it's supposed to be part, truthfully, the most honest thing I saw is that somebody said, well, we had this great women's march to protest Trump's inauguration. We have to do something to keep the momentum going. So they invented something else.
Is it a good idea for women to demonstrate this way? If they had, say, a cause that they could actually crystallize around this, that's lack of focus seems to be part of the problem here. Is it a good idea to say, look, we're going to show everybody what it would be like if women didn't contribute to the economy or to society or in other ways for a day?
No, I think that's actually pretty silly, if the truth be known. I mean, the real point is not their so-called economic power. The real point is to be out in the street making themselves visible, in your face, present. That's the point of the thing. The economic power, it's not enough to make a difference, really. I'd be shocked if something happened to the stock market or something like that as a result of the so-called protest today. I think the thing that's really telling is what do they want? They aren't even telling you what they want. And so, you know, the way I spent this day was I wrote a blog post about forced abortion in China. And I wonder why the International Women's Day never says anything about forced abortion in China, which is, you know, when you look at the coercive one-child policy that has been enacted in China and has been going on for decades now, it's the longest, most intrusive violation of human rights in a long, long time. And nobody says anything about it. The left doesn't say anything about it. The libertarians don't say anything about it. You'd think the libertarians would have something to say about a government demanding that you have a birth permit before you have a child, you know, but nobody ever wants to talk about that. So, and the reason they don't is because that fits in with their agenda. You know, that's all part of the population control lifestyle left agenda, making abortion and contraception normalized and everything. And so, you know, they just overlook the fact that women are strapped down and forcibly aborted. So it just shows the incoherence of the modern left and really the modern right, too, as far as that's concerned. You know, I mean, good Christians, I think, barely have a home, a comfortable home in modern politics these days.
You mentioned a connection with the kind of the previously existing feminist holiday on March 8th, which is the UN-sanctioned International Women's Day. What was that supposed to be about?
I don't know what the UN is trying to do, but it's a day. I think when they come up with these days that they're having, Todd, it's a day for them to put their propaganda out. It's a day for them to have an excuse to be on the TV or on the radio talking about their issues, you know. You know, maybe we need to do something like that. Maybe we need to come up with International Day of the Natural Family and put out press releases, and maybe people would interview us, you know. But that's all it has ever been, is a media event so that they can get their message onto the airwaves.
I mentioned before, Jennifer, that I think it was one of my pastor friends earlier today posted on social media that he was just flipping around the channels looking at the media coverage of a Day Without a Woman protest. And he said,
yes,
I saw a lot of abortion, reproductive rights signs and very few other issues on display. Does that surprise you?
No, that doesn't surprise me at all. I mean, that's what it's all about. And really, if you think about it, even that's kind of ridiculous, because it's not like Donald Trump has abolished abortion. He just said, you have to pay for it yourself. He just said, U.S. tax dollars are not going to go overseas to promote this form of cultural imperialism overseas. That's what he's saying. And they think that that's an attack on women, you know, and they never stop to look at the real attacks on women, which I've mentioned, you know, the issue of forced abortion, population control in general. We are despised around the third world because people don't want our population control agenda. They don't want our cultural imperialism coming in after them. And it's, so, you know, the idea that American women are oppressed and upset because Donald Trump did something that they don't like, and in the meantime, they're turning their backs on women around the world who are seriously oppressed, who are being seriously harmed. They say nothing at all about the oppression of women in Muslim countries, for example. They say nothing about any of that. So, you know, obviously, this is a ploy to get attention for their particular issues that they care about for reasons that have nothing to do with women. And, you know, I thought it was very interesting, the sound clip that you played. This is what democracy looks like. This is what they think democracy looks like. They think democracy means a lot of people getting in the street, making noise, and basically pushing people to accept them and to do what they want, right? That is actually not what democracy means. That is what thuggery means. That is what the rule of the mob means. Whoever can pay for the biggest mob to go out in the street, that's who wins. No, that is not democracy at all whatsoever.
I'm intrigued that it has been called a strike, and that one of the major emphases here was that you stay home from work for a day and all our employers and the government and everyone will kind of feel the pinch a little bit and appreciate women a little bit more the day after today. But I'm looking at this, or trying to look at this, from the perspective of someone, say a blue-collar worker for whom a strike isn't a one-day affair, to which they get to go back to their job the next day without any repercussions. A strike is a prolonged affair, and it entails considerable risk on the part of the worker who undergoes it. What are your thoughts there as an economist?
Well, first of all, this idea of a strike for a political cause, that's your clue that this is right out of the leftist playbook, because that's what they like to call their events, right? So they're calling it a strike to hearken back to all of these other causes that, you know, warm the hearts of all of their good left-wing people. But it's true, this particular day off from work entails no risk whatsoever for the vast majority of these people who are doing it. And you're right, the typical strike for working conditions and so on, for better working conditions and wages and all of that, that can't, historically, that could entail serious risk on the part of the part of the people going on strike. Now, as things stand now, the right to strike is well regulated in law and so on and so forth, and so it's not as risky as it once was. But it is not a one day affair. You know, the point of a strike is to make it pinch, and nobody gets pinched from one day of a worker not being there. You have to be prepared to go the distance on something like this. And so this is a gesture. This is political theater, Todd. This is political theater. That's what it is, and people need to understand that that's what it is. And so, if any of your listeners have friends who, you know, are sympathetic to this, or who did it, or who wore red today, or something like that, have them ask your friend, ask that person, what do you think about forced abortion in China? Why are we not saying anything about that? Isn't that a much more serious issue for International Women's Day than anything that's going on in the United States?
Political theater, but has it been, or can it be scripted carefully enough? And the reason I ask that, Jennifer, is that it's called A Day Without a Woman, International Women's Day, and that seems to be on a collision course with the gender politics that feminism partakes in, actually kind of gave birth to.
What do you mean? I'm not following you, Todd.
Well, these are women, and what if I'm a transgendered woman? What if I'm neither man or woman? What about my rights?
Good point. So let's say you identify as a woman. Are you welcome at these rallies? That's a good point. Actually, that's quite an interesting point, because in some there are some feminists who would not welcome a transgender man, a male-bodied individual claiming to be a woman. That person would not be welcomed by a great many radical feminists at this point in time. So that's quite interesting. And in fact, I remember thinking that I think I even put this on my Facebook page. You know, they have this funny Facebook meme of a dinosaur looking puzzled and confused. And so I used that dinosaur image and put on, if they don't believe in the sex of the body, why are they marching for women? You know, and the movement is sinking into incoherence. But that doesn't mean that it's harmless, and that doesn't mean that it's going to peter out all on its own. People need to be aware and alert to the fact that these people can do a lot of damage, and the fact that they're incoherent and that they're illogical and all the rest of it means that it will take a lot of force to do what they're trying to do. Doing the impossible takes a lot of force and takes a lot of propaganda, and that's why it's not harmless, even though it's just political theater. It's not just political theater. That political theater has a very serious purpose. And conservatives and non-radicals, I guess we could say, are not nearly attentive enough and don't take this stuff nearly as seriously as we really should, in my opinion.
Can we distinguish between the true activists here, the people who have organized it, who, by the way, are all kind of cushy, tenured academic elites, who risk nothing by protesting one day. And the average kind of, let's just call her the average soccer mom who gets caught up in the hoopla and shows up and wears red or decides to not show up for her job. Can we distinguish between those two kind of people?
Well, probably we can. I mean, I think I'm sure there are people such as you describe, you know, people who have some kind of grievance and who see this as a way of advancing their aims. And what I would say to that person, you know, if you've never been involved in feminism before and you've never gone to any of these rallies and, you know, you're a soccer mom and you think, gosh, this is unfair or whatever, I'm going to be involved, I would just invite you to think about what's going on around you, whether you want to be part of something that is this angry and that is this disruptive and that is this narrow and narrow-minded about what it means to be a successful woman and what society owes to women, to have such a narrow perception of what counts there. Just ask yourself, is this something you really want to be involved in? And I think there probably are some people, you know, who go and who don't really realize, you know, quite what they're walking into. And so I would encourage them to dig a little deeper, look at the symbolism, look at all those pro-abortion signs, and ask yourself, do I really belong here?
Why must feminism, and in a lot of ways the sexual revolution in general, why must it always behave as though it is one day away from women being stripped of the right to vote, drive cars, things like that?
Well, because that hysteria is part of what keeps people motivated. That's part of what keeps people, you know, if you, I guess it's called the low information voter or the low information media consumer. It's a direct play on people's emotions. And it's a very manipulative kind of technique that gets used to make people think that the situation's desperate and we need you right now. And if you don't do anything about it, you're going to be left out. You're going to be left behind. You're on the wrong side of history. All this type of rhetoric is meant to motivate people to do what they want you to do, which in this case is to show up at their rally. But it's also meant to make you feel socially isolated. If you don't do it, nobody's going to like you. If you don't do it, you're going to be a bigot. If you don't do it, you're going to be left behind, and you're going to be alone. And that's the point of a lot of that rhetoric that creates urgency and so on. That's the point of creating the sensation that or sort of surrounding people who don't toe the line or participate and making them feel ostracized. It's a kind of manipulation technique.
Answer your own question from before. You said you wrote an essay on forced abortions in China. Why is it that the UN-sanctioned International Women's Day, or its present manifestation here, a day without a woman to strike, why is it that that is not an issue for them? Answer your question.
Well, because they are indirectly complicit in that atrocity, and they don't really see it as an atrocity, some of them. In their opinion, the reigning dogma is that we have overpopulation and we have oppression of women, and the only solution to those things is to have more abortion and more contraception and fewer children. And so for them to look closely at what the one-child policy actually means in actual people's lives would mean they would have to question all of that other stuff. They would have to question that basic commitment to so-called reproductive freedom or reproductive rights, that all of that would be undermined. And so they just can't look at it too closely. You know, see that movement is a combination of movements. It's a combination of people. On the one hand, you've got the women's movement people who believe that they have to be able to get rid of babies in order to achieve their life goals and their economic and career goals. They have to be able to get rid of babies whenever they want to. So you've got that kind of feminism married together with the old-time population control people. The fact is, the old-time population control people back in the day, Todd, they didn't give a rip about women or women's rights. They just wanted to have fewer kids around. They wanted to slow the growth of the population so that we could get to some kind of sustainable number of people on the planet. And these people are still around. But they've, at some point in the 1970s, they figured out that just saying we need to control the population, that was not a good enough sales package. They figured out that saying we're going to empower women by reducing fertility and by giving them the choice and the power to reduce their fertility, that solves our problem, because now our population limitation goals look much more attractive because they're wrapped up in women's rights. And women who have fewer children, and as women get more education, they're naturally going to have fewer children, because that's just the pattern. As you have more education, more income, people's fertility choices, they reduce the number of children they choose to have. So that kind of unholy alliance, that has been crucial to keeping this whole thing going. The population control people needed to shut up about population control as their dogma, as their ultimate goal. If they just keep talking about women's rights and women's empowerment, if they dress it all up in that, they can achieve a lot of their objectives. And so the women who have signed on to that, who have said, you know, yes, by golly, this is our goal, reproductive rights. That's what we're all about. That empowers women. That's good for women. They're to me, they're the dupes. They're the ones who are being used, because all of the aspects of the population control agenda that are harmful to women, that undermine their true desires, that are harmful to their bodies, all of that, they just kind of sweep that under the rug. And the feminists who really do care about that, and there still are some, Todd, there are still feminists who are like, you know, we're experimenting on women's bodies with all of these hormonal chemicals and, you know, all that type of a concern that's still out there. But those feminists, you never hear about them. They're not in front of those parades. They're not in front of the media. That doesn't serve the narrative. And so those people are set aside. And so that's why they can't look at China. They can't look at a situation where babies are killed, are set aside for destruction because they're girls, right? And they can't look too closely at what's really involved with saying we're going to limit people's population. We're going to control. We're going to have governmental control of fertility. They just can't look at it too closely because it upsets that very delicate balance that here in the West we have created between the population controllers and the feminists.
With about 30 seconds, so how are you observing a day without a woman protest?
Well, I'm talking to my good friend Todd Wilkin about forced abortion in China. That's my idea of how to spend my day. I'm still doing my work, Todd. I'm not taking the day off, that's for sure.
Folks, you can meet and hear Dr. Jennifer Roback-Morris at the Winter Issues, Etc. Making the Case Conference, November the 10th and the 11th in Houston, Texas. She'll be joined by Rod Dreher, Mark and Molly Hemingway, Pastor Brian Wolfmiller, and Scott Murray. You can find out more about this conference and our Summer Making the Case Conference, June 9th and 10th in Collinsville, Illinois, at issuesetc.org or call 618-223-8385. Dr. Jennifer Roback-Morris is founder and president of the Ruth Institute. She taught economics for 15 years at Yale and George Mason Universities. She is senior research fellow in economics for the Acton Institute and author of several books, including her latest, The Sexual Revolution and Its Victims. Find a link to it at our website, issuesetc.org. Click Listen on Demand. Jennifer, thank you very much.
You're very welcome, Todd.
You've just been listening to Dr. J and Todd Wilkin discussing the Day Without a Woman protest this week on Issues, Etc. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org, and we're also on Facebook. Like the Ruth Institute or Dr. Jennifer Roback-Morris pages for updates. Our podcasts can be found online at ruthinstitute.org and iTunes, and as always, they're under a Creative Commons license. If you've enjoyed them, please share them with friends. The Ruth Institute is a nonprofit educational organization devoted to bringing hope and encouragement for lifelong married love and healing within the family.